When we began planning this event last fall, there were those among us on the library's events planning team who advocated for holding this event on the evening of January 19th. There were those among us who opined that, really, it would make no difference who the prime celebrant of the following day's festivities would wind up being. The landing of the flying saucers in D.C. would be highly apropos regardless. In the event, the flying saucers, or at least our flying saucers, have landed a few weeks after Inauguration Day rather than the night before, and this allows us, I hope, to take a break from our current political obsessions and think about unrelated matters. Or are they as unrelated as we might think? What, after all, have UFOs and flying saucers to do with the distinguished holdings of the Booth Family Center for Special Collections at Georgetown? We are in the process of receiving the donations of two extensive collections of science fiction. One is a group of almost 2,000 first editions donated by retired university librarian Susan K. Martin, who has read every book she donated. And the one she hasn't donated yet, she hasn't donated because she's still reading them. She's wonderful. The other is a significant collection of pioneering science fiction writers, Isaac Asimov, Robert Heinlein, Philip K. Dick, in process of being given by university board member Thomas J. Healy. We're very grateful to both of them. There is certainly a complementarity there. But whatever you might say about the Jack Womack collection of flying saucer books, you cannot say that any of them purport to be fiction. Indeed, the subtitle of one of my favorite items, you can see it upstairs, the pseudonymously authored The Elvis UFO Connection, the subtitle pointedly reads, A Non-Fiction Account of Alien Intervention. Perhaps the Womack collection has a closer analog in Georgetown's extensive holdings relating to the history of intelligence and espionage. In the exhibition upstairs, you can see the first post-war reports about unidentified flying objects. You can see the model for the X-Files Scully. You can see the original Men in Black. And you can ask yourself, how do we understand the phenomenon of the conspiracy theory? And how do we differentiate between good intel and bad, between propaganda and rumor, and, dare I say these two phrases, between media bias and fake news? Or perhaps these books have just as much to do with Georgetown's extensive holdings relating to the history of the Society of Jesus. One of my favorite books among our science fiction holdings is Mary Doria Russell's The Sparrow, in which a Jesuit linguist participates in a first contact mission to a newly discovered world inhabited, of course, by sentient beings. It's really a theodicy, but we won't go into that. The problem of evil. Like our Jesuit collections, the Womack Flying Saucer Collection has as much to do with the nature and structures of belief, the possibilities of a universe far bigger than our forebears ever imagined, the mysteries of space, time, and infinity, as with anything else. Forming the basis for a truly, can't resist, out-of-this-world exhibition, the collection was assembled by author Jack Womack and includes books, typescripts, photos, pamphlets, and magazines that detail the flying saucer phenomenon that gripped the United States during the second half of the 20th century. It is a tour de force of collecting. capturing the ephemeral and the fringe and bringing the core of a movement together in a fashion that will support much future study and research and scholarship. In September 2016, Mr. Womack's extensive UFO library was cataloged and published in a book entitled Flying Saucers Are Real. Copies will be available for sale and for signing after the talk and during the reception. Joining us this evening to discuss the collection is Jack Womack himself and Washington Post book critic Michael Dirda. Mr. Womack has written numerous novels and was the recipient of the Philip K. Dick Award for Distinguished Science Fiction in 1994. Mr. Dirda scarcely needs an introduction here in his hometown, so I'll leave it at saying he is a Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist and book reviewer for a paper called The Washington Post. Following the discussion, we invite you to view the exhibition on the fifth floor and to join us for a reception. Now, please welcome Jack Womack and Michael Dirda.
Thank you, John, for that introduction. Can you all hear us or hear me? You want to say something?
Can you hear me? All right, okay. I believe so.
Well, I thought we would just have a kind of general, easygoing conversation about flying saucers. But I would hope that there will be questions. So please think about questions you might like to raise later in the evening about almost anything at all relating to UFOs, and particularly to the books and the materials that Jack has collected over the years, if you've had a chance to see the exhibition upstairs. But let's start. Tell us a little about your background. Where'd you grow up?
Well, where are you from? I grew up in Lexington, Kentucky. I moved here to New York in 1970.
Not in New York.
I know, I always, but there is only one place. Anyway. I moved up in 1977, trying to come up at the most appropriate time, and I quickly find myself in New York, which everyone who's seen Taxi Driver, it actually did look like that when I moved up. It looks nothing remotely like that now, but I've sort of adjusted over the years since
I looked. Is it better or worse?
It's in most ways better, in some ways worse, because the great wonderful stores, the 78 stores, the paperback stores, the vinyl stores, those have all been priced out, like they have in every city pretty much in the U.S.
Well, when you were growing up in Kentucky, were you interested in flying saucers then?
From when I was 8 years old.
Well, what happened when you were eight? Did you
when
see one?
I was eight, no. I've never actually seen a flying saucer. My mother claimed to have seen a flying saucer, but the way she described it, I believe what she saw was an advertising plane that I saw about 6 weeks later at the 4th of July celebration. As it was flying over, I was thinking, yeah, that looks awfully a lot like that flying saucer my mother saw.
Another illusion shattered.
Yeah. So, but what happened with me was I was just watching television one morning show. There is a local morning show with local morning hosts. And this gives you an idea of TV back in the 60s. They spent 20 minutes talking about this paperback book that one of them had seen and then had picked up and then was saying, this is just wonderful, He was a very wonderful fellow, except he tended to wear his socks too short so that whenever he crossed his legs, you'd get a whole, like, display of shin. But the book sounded, it was called Strange World, and it is upstairs.
By Frank Edwards.
It is upstairs as one of the exhibits. That was the very first book I got because as soon as I saw the show, I convinced my grandmother to take me around the corner to the Rexall drugstore in our neighborhood, which was called Chevy Chase, by the way. But it was the Lexington. It was the Lexington Chevy Chase as opposed to the one around here. But walked around, bought the book, took it home, read it repeatedly. Thought to myself, boy, this would be great to believe. I was 8 years old at the time, but somehow
you were skeptical. I didn't discover that, but I first read Frank Edwards' Stranger Than Science, which was a collection of his columns from newspapers about weird things that were supposedly true.
That was his.
And I believed all of them. Because, you know, I've always been naive. But
I just went in just thinking, this sounds really fascinating, but somehow it just sounds too good to be true. But there are really great stories. There is one about a couple of cops who were patrolling West Philadelphia, and in the middle of like 26th Street, they came upon this glowing purple glob, like just in the middle of the intersection, and like, you know, cops, they just said, well, hello, we've just seen a large glowing blob, it's purple. Yes, okay, so yeah, talk to you later. And nothing ever came of it. So, but it conjured up all sorts of notions of what was possible. See, I had never gotten into science fiction as a child, except for the movies. I liked the movies that showed up, and would go see them, the old ones and new ones. But science fiction novels didn't really get my attention until I wrote my, well, actually, until I wrote my first novel, and my publisher said, this is science fiction. Are you familiar with science fiction? I said, no, not really. Well, you should read some science fiction. And so they gave me the name of a lot of authors I should read, and I read them. And most of them, I thought to myself, gee, I can't say I'm really sorry I haven't read this until now. But Strange World was like, it brought out the sense of wonder that I know David Hartwell used to talk about.
All the science fiction always talking about, save sense of wonder.
And it brought out that same thing of just making you think, what if this was true?
Did you look for other books about flying saucers?
I started looking for other books on flying saucers then, and that's when my collection started.
So when you were 8, you were already looking?
I was already looking, yeah.
Do you remember what you found afterwards?
Yeah, the first major score I remember after that was a new used bookstore opened up downtown, and they had 12 of the books that are in the collection.
12?
Upstairs, and they were all like, of course, at the time, I think the most expensive one was $1, and some was...
Were they all paperbacks? Or?
No, hardcovers. They were the hardcover first editions and such that I got. So I said, oh, this is wonderful. So got all those, and then...
And you read them?
And then I read them all. I will say I have read all the flying saucer books in the collection upstairs, except for the ones that are written so obviously by the mentally disturbed that's actually sort of impossible to make sense of what's even being said. But those can be entertaining in their own way. But I started buying used paperbacks. There's a great used bookstore downtown, so I would buy used paperbacks or hardcovers when I would see them. We'd sometimes visit, I was living in Lexington, sometimes we'd go to Louisville, and then I'd hit the used bookstores up there, of which there were a few still good, really good ones downtown at the time. And over time, the collection just grew. It wasn't until the 90s that I really started being able to find a lot of the books that I'd always heard of.
So when you left Lexington and you moved to New York, but how many books in your flying saucer collection did you have?
I already had about 100 or so by then. And then started finding more, of course, in New York. And then when I started writing my novels and going on book tours and things, I'd hit a lot more bookstores. And the greatest score I ever had was the first time I ever went to Powell's in Portland. And walked out with like 2 bags because I basically just cleaned out their entire... UFO shelves where obviously it's just like, has no one ever looked at these before?
I have a son who lives in Portland, so I visit Powell's a lot, but it's hard to find, really bargains anymore, it seems. Even in the occult sections.
Yeah, and that was just usually where you find the bargains.
Yeah.
But at the time, it was one, they were like, $5, $10. I think the most expensive was like $15, but this is in the early 90s. Is in the early 90s, so I brought a lot back and just And I always get questions like, are you a dealer? I said, no, I wish I was, because I could give you my tax form, but no such luck. But over time, I just gradually got them. Now, what happened was that by the early 80s, flying saucers, of course, were much more, had settled much more into the general public consciousness than they had been earlier, or was still a little specialized through the 60s up until the 70s. Basically, as soon as the government decided there was nothing to investigate about flying saucers, that was when everybody really got into the act. And you started seeing books on the connections between flying saucers and Bigfoot, or the connection between flying saucers and whether or not people live on the moon, or do they live on the moon, or do they live inside the moon? Is the moon actually a big spaceship itself? You'd have all sorts of theories, none of which had ever had any evidence whatsoever to really back them up, but would be entertaining. But what happened in the early 80s was, after the first when the contactees, there's a distinction between contactees. These are the people in the 50s and 60s generally, who, when they saw flying saucers and if they saw their occupants, they'd come and they'd talk about mysteries of the universe, which would usually make as much sense as mysteries of the universe being told by someone channeled from Atlantis. There is absolutely, things will be very different in the future, would be, things the flying saucer people would tell, and you'd think, well, that's very nice, but I kind of could have guessed that, so I can't say this is a sign of a truly advanced intelligence. But by the early 80s, what was happening was that everyone was being abducted by little gray aliens, and then being probed or having things inserted into them, like mechanical things as well as other things. And it just became sort of boring, basically.
Well, your collection stops at like about 1970, doesn't it?
It stops. It went a little later. It goes to like basically...
But you don't get into Whitley Strieber and Communion and all that kind of stuff.
That was what basically sort of turned me off of
let's,
it.
Let's go back to... How did the flying saucer craze get started in America? What started it?
The flying saucer craze in America got started in a wonderful way, and it actually has to do with science fiction. What happened was, one of the leading science fiction editors of the early 1940s, Ray Palmer, who is quite a character in and of himself, received a letter one day from someone named Richard Shaver. And so, his assistant threw it in the trash, said, oh no, it's just another crank letter and everything. But because in it he proposed, so he said, dear Mr. Palmer, I have discovered the secret of the first universal language of mankind, which is known as man tongue, as he put it, which was entertaining enough in itself. And so Palmer stuck it back and said, would you write me a little more? Tell me more about this. And so in return, Richard Shaver sent him back a 10,000 word manuscript entitled A Warning to Future Man. And Palmer said, oh, I've got gold here. So he rewrote it, republished it in Amazing Stories, which is one of the great old pulps of the 30s and 40s. He renamed it, he thought the title didn't quite fly, so he renamed it I Remember Lemuria, and told about the people, the great ones who used to live inside the earth, until the carbon shell that surrounds the sun burned away. Never an explanation of how that precisely happened. The great ones left, except for a few they left behind, who degenerated and became what was known as the Darrow. And the Darrow supposedly lived inside the earth and would do sneaky things, like they had it set up so that if you pressed the wrong button in an elevator and you went down to the sub-basement, they'd grab you and carry you off. Or if you went to the far end of one of the more empty subway platforms, they'd haul you off that way. And then they'd take you off and turn you into a slave and kill you and eat you and terrible things. And it was only after he'd written, only after 6 months later, that Shaver happened to mention to Palmer that he had found out about the Dero and about the screams, and he'd heard the screams of the Dero through his welding equipment in Detroit in 1932, and which did suggest possibly a different explanation for the voices. But by this point, Palmer was flying with the Shaver mystery, and that went on for 2 years, drove everyone in science fiction crazy. I mean, you probably knew. Oh, I knew some guys who you just say the name Shaver mystery.
There were a couple of books that came out in the last year or two about this.
Really? Yeah. See, I pay no attention to the newest stuff, but that's fascinating. I'd love to see
a biography of Palmer.
Oh, nice. He was an interesting character. Yeah. But anyway, so he got away with this for a couple of years, and Forrest J. Ackerman, who later became the publisher of Famous Monsters of Filmland, hated it, was completely saying, no, we've got to get rid of all things Shaverian. Harlan Ellison, who was a teenager at the time, would just be writing about, what are you doing writing this trash? What are you doing? What is this nonsense? What is this foolishness? Basically Palmer was a born provocateur in some way, so he'd just sort of try to goad them along into and just say, it makes you think, doesn't it? And just, think about it. And so he got away with this for a couple of years and started Fate magazine, which for many years was like the leading pulp that covered
Sort of Charles Fort kind of thing.
You
want to tell them about Charles? Well, maybe.
Fort was on a much higher level than Ray Palmer, but Charles Fort was the great American crank and great literature, who did four books back in the first part of the 20th century on the first collections of strange phenomena.
Inexplicable phenomena.
Yeah. If you saw the film, anyone who saw the film Magnolia will remember the fall of frogs at the end. And actually you see a copy of the book Low early on in this thing. And just the falls of frogs, lights in the sky, mysterious disappearances. These were the first compilations.
Fort claimed that we were like pets of aliens. So we were kept here on Earth and they would visit us.
Yeah, who owns this?
The Book of the Damned is the big collection.
But Low is the best one by far. That's the one that I think should actually be in the Library of America. It's so beautifully written.
Well, you'll do the introduction. You'll be the editor.
I would be very happy to do that.
Here we've got the Dero living underground. Do we get to flying saucers from outer space?
Well, we get to them because just as the Shaver mystery was starting to lose, the legs were starting to give out on the Shaver mystery, Kenneth Arnold, a commercial pilot and also a private pilot in Yakima, Washington, was flying one day over the Cascades in 1947. This would have been about June 24th, 1947. And he reported in that he saw 9 flying silvery disks across the Cascades, and I just phoned it in to report, I don't know what these are. When he landed, there were some press people waiting, including some guy from the East Oregonian who took down the report and then put the story out on the wire, including the term flying saucers.
Is this the first use of the term?
The first use of the term was the day after in a Hearst article. That's where he had used it before, but they picked it up from him, but that was the first, they were the first people to pick it up. And this was on June 26th that you saw flying saucers. And then a very early example of how viral transmission worked prior to the internet, by June 27th, the next day, flying saucers had appeared in all world journals. It was astounding. It went out on the wires and it went out very quickly, and then people started seeing them themselves, and hundreds of reports started coming in. When Ray Palmer had started putting in the Shaver stories, people had written in about how they'd experienced the Dero, how they'd fought it out with them during the war, how they found them in caves and escaped being captured, and hundreds of people You can just see the wheels clicking as suddenly, oh, this sounds good, and yes, I think it did happen to me. So a couple of days, about a month after this first sighting, which brought worldwide attention to them, Ray Palmer got in touch with Kenneth Arnold and said, listen, there is another flying saucer sighting the day after yours. And it was off Maury Island in Puget Sound. And would you investigate that for me? And so he said, well, okay, all right, sure. So he wrote it out. This was after Palmer had convinced him to write an account of the saucers that he'd seen, which Palmer reprinted and rewrote and then put in Fate under the title, I Did See the Flying Discs. So just to make sure it was very clear and there's no uncertainty about that. Arnold went to Tacoma, met one of the two people who said that this happened, this flying saucer had appeared over Puget Sound, dropped metal slag over their boat, where it scared the crew and killed the dog and hurt his son, and then flew off, and he had some slag. His boss, there was this guy, and then his boss who kept some of the saucer metal, as he called it, and he'd be very interested in getting together and showing him some of the saucer metal and taking it further. Now, a little later that same day, Dahl and Crisman was his boss. Dahl said he was walking down the streets of Tacoma when suddenly a brand new 1947 Buick pulled up alongside him and a man said, you'd better get in, we need to talk to you. So he got in, they went to the local coffee shop or diner or whatever, and the guy proceeded to say, I know everything that happened to you yesterday, and I can tell you, you'd better not tell anyone else. And he recounted exactly what had happened.
He was in a black suit.
And he was wearing a black suit. The first man in black showed up with the very first flying saucer on the ground incident, as it were, using basically the same stories, because then what Dahl did was take him over to the Criswin's secretary's house, who supposedly was keeping track of the saucer metal, though she couldn't find it right there immediately, though did find a little piece of iron that sort of looked like it could have been from it, said, oh, here you go, this is an example, but Criswin has much more. As Arnold was leaving, he happened to notice that the secretary seemed to be using a piece of saucer metal as an ashtray. So he was starting to reconsider exactly what was happening. There are a couple of Army Air Force fellows in town who were interviewing, who were debriefing Arnold on his sighting. And so they wanted to come along when he said, all right, I'm going to talk to Crisman. He says he's promised to bring over the saucer medal, tell us all about the story. They met like at 9 o'clock at night because he wasn't available otherwise. Crisman came over, told exactly the same story that he'd heard already with nothing new. And then around midnight, they said, didn't you have some saucer medal you were going to bring? Oh, I knew there was something I forgot. And sure enough, he said, let me go back home and look for it. Well, the Army Air Force guys just said, oh, the hell with this. And so they left, flew back. The next morning, their plane, as it's flying back to Washington, crashes, and they're both killed. Arnold, at this point, really is not liking any of this. They go by to see the secretary's house, and the secretary's house.
Wasn't there suspicion there was sabotage?
Sabotage was hinted in the local papers, though sabotage by whom was never inferred, suggested, implied. It was just sabotage hinted at. So they go back, and the secretary's house is now abandoned. Crisman has decided to take off and go to Alaska for a few months just for the heck of it, leaving. Just says, oh, well, I'll be here if you need me. And just taking off. Palmer, Arnold had had quite enough. So he calls Palmer in New York and says, look, this is ridiculous. This is bizarre. I just can't deal with it. Take me off. Now, at that point, Arnold found out that the person from whom Palmer had originally gotten the story was, in fact, Crisman, who had 3 years earlier written a letter in to Amazing Stories talking about the firefight he'd had with Darrow in the caves of Burma in 1944. So at this point, Arnold's just saying, oh, please, just, you know.
So Arnold had become skeptical of all
this?
He
was very skeptical. He still wrote several. He wrote a pamphlet. He wrote a book. Arnold wrote those. Palmer is believed to have actually done the writing.
Well, what did Arnold think of what he'd seen at this point? Did he think he had hallucinated it?
I don't know what, in fact, he thought he'd seen. I've never actually seen a reference. He just said, basically, he said, I don't know what I saw, but this is what I saw.
And from this, everything's...
From this, it got, grew. You had many more. Just one last note for regarding Crisman. Just to show you how things work in this field. 20 years later, Crisman was put down as the first witness that Jim Garrison wanted to call for his own Kennedy assassination trial, since Crisman had been the first person that Clay Shaw had phoned after the assassination. And though he was never brought to stand, there are still people, you know, there are theories proposed on this for many years, and people who still haunt Dealey Plaza, you know, always thought, oh, well, Crisman must have been like on the grassy knoll, or he must have been on the viaduct.
So is this implying that aliens had something to do with the Kennedy assassination?
This was all these conspiracy, by the 60s, all the conspiracies were beginning to take shape as one gigantic, all-encompassing theory that, oh, well, that must be because of the saucer people, or that must be because of the government, because the government, suspicion of the government had begun very early on with this, because the government didn't know what they were themselves and were trying to figure it out, or they had their own secret projects going on. They didn't want anyone to know. And it's only now that a lot of these papers are actually being declassified, so you can even tell what they were thinking about it at the time. But they just...
Well,
yes.
You know, given this is called Flying Saucers Over D.C., there was a very famous sighting over D.C., which I looked up.
1952.
And I'll read you what Wikipedia, just the beginning of their account, to give you a sense of what was going on. At 11:40 p.m. on Saturday, July 19, 1952, Edward Nugent, an air traffic controller at Washington National Airport, spotted seven objects on his radar. The objects were located 15 miles south-southwest of the city. No known aircraft were in the area, and the objects were not following any established flight paths. Nugent's superior, Harry Barnes, a senior air traffic controller at the airport, watched the objects on Nugent's radar scope. He later wrote, "We knew immediately that a very strange situation existed. Their movements were completely radical compared to those of ordinary aircraft." Barnes had two controllers check Nugent's radar. They found that it was working normally. Barnes then called National Airport's radar-equipped control tower. The controllers there, Howard Cochlin and Joe Zacco, both said that they had seen a bright light hovering in the sky. It took off, zooming away at incredible speed. At this point, other objects appeared in all sectors of the radar scope when they moved over the White House and the United States Capitol. And I'll stop there. It goes on. And then the following few days later, they see more. Various explanations were given. The most popular one being a heat inversion or temperature?
Heat inversion, radar angels, phenomena, weather phenomena were usually ascribed to having caused the sightings, but the radar sightings.
Now, the government obviously was aware of this UFO phenomenon. How did they respond to it? They're saying Project Blue Book and things like that.
Project Blue Book, they did investigate for a little while, or gave every indication of investigating. To what degree they really investigated, as opposed to just basically trying to figure out new ways to just cover it up, is still a question, because as more papers are from the period are declassified, the more puzzling it gets, because you become aware that the government was actually really as baffled by some of the things as anyone seeing them were. And others, they suspiciously say absolutely nothing about. And those are the ones you suspect probably there is some reality in the background, but they weren't going to say. But what it did was cause people to believe more and more that the government was lying. And this is like where some of the very first anti-government conspiracies come up, to only develop to fruition later in the 80s, 90s, and since then. And you'll see these things now, just there's been less in the past 15, 16 years, I think, in terms of saucer sightings, and for that matter, sightings of any odd phenomena, sea serpents, the abominable snowman, et cetera, since the development of cell phones. Because at the time, when people had, you know, only photographers basically were wandering around with their cameras, it was one thing. But when everyone in the country basically has a phone and can start taking photos of whatever strange phenomena they're seeing, considering that they can capture meteors coming to Earth now with fair regularity, no flying saucers, strangely enough, have shown up. No UFOs, no Yetis, no sea serpents. A great number of wonderful Fortean phenomena seems to be fading away, simply because you can now figure out that it was caused by something else. But with flying saucers, for many years, it became not only just a sort of sport to look at the sky at night and see what you might see flying around when most everyone was interested, and then became something like, well, what are they doing? Are they looking at us? Is it becoming dangerous? And then what was interesting when I went back to do this book was rereading the Maury Island incident, which was, again, in July 1947, at the very beginnings of the phenomena, and realizing that this is basically the perfect X-Files episode right here, because it had everything. It had disappearing people, it had mysterious deaths, it had science without science, it had peculiar individuals showing up out of nowhere, it had Men in Black, and it even had, I remember reading in the early 70s, accounts of how someone said, then the 1947 Buick pulled up and it smelled like it had just been driven fresh off the lot, and the Men in Black got off, and I suddenly realized they're talking about the 1947 story, and this is the same Buick that smelled brand new in 1947 that is still smelling brand new in 1971. And, you know, these things give you room to pause, if you want.
Now, it's clear that you're skeptical about flying saucers, to say the least.
I believe in the people who see flying saucers.
I mean, did you ever have any second thoughts that maybe there is something here that is more than meets the eye?
I have thought that there are.
And any other books or any other incidents?
I have thought on occasion, many times in Ford, I find things with just odd things, simply because of the time period where they happened and the fact that they hadn't been elaborated upon, but he used newspapers as often as scientific journals, which made it always sort of hard. You have to go back and actually read the originals of each to see which were possible and which were not. So I remember one account in Book of the Damned of what in the book is supposedly an angel seen in the sky, which when you go to the original text of the article turns out to be a cloud shaped like an angel that was seen in the sky. And so gradually a lot of those phenomena have been whittled down, but there are still plenty of mysterious things out there. The majority of mid-century flying saucer sightings, though, I think it was just basically, I want to get in on the act.
So do you think they were deliberately lying?
No, no. I think it was like misinterpretation.
I want to believe.
I think there were definitely hoaxes, and there were some lies and things like that. They proved very popular, and there are lots of pie plates on the end of fishing poles, you know, with a camera, you know, about to.
Remember one of the books you say is you've never seen such a collection of smudges and glares and everything supposedly representing the flying saucer.
Oh, it's just
photographs.
My favorite is one of the ones where you have a bunch of hula dancers in the foreground, and there's this tiny little smudge in the back, and it's like, see, the dancers are paying no attention to what's going on behind them. And they're just like, and you see other photos where there's a smudge in the lens, and the people are looking in this direction. But they're saying, people watching flying saucers sail over Taormina. No, that's not where they're looking at all. No. So
when did the flying saucer books start to become really bizarre? When they started
70s.
The Elvis, you know, Jesus was really an alien pulled up by tractor beams when he ascended. Did that happen?
Some of the early contactee narratives are pretty peculiar. From the early 50s. I remember, I'm thinking in particular of Aboard a Flying Saucer by Truman Bethlehem, who met what was called a scow, piloted by little guys and a tall, beautiful space captain who one gets the idea of, and I can't help feeling Angelina Jolie more the case, because she had this because he describes her clothing, it's this fetching beret and Paris New Look outfit, you know. There's always been a rumor that she was named as the co-respondent in Truman's second divorce. But because he was going out in the desert and spending a whole lot of time with
this alien woman.
And there are letters in existence written by her that are saying, we've got to stop hanging out with these people all the time. This is ridiculous. But he finally divorced, and then he got remarried to a different contactee at Giant Rock, which is where the UFO conventions used to be held.
Is that a particular?
Giant Rock is in the Mojave Desert. And it's a great big rock that, that's what it is, the big rock. And they bought it and they held the science fiction conventions there. George Van Tassel did for about 20, 25 years. And you would get like up to 10,000 people showing up for them in the middle of the desert to sell books, describe their experiences, which were always, at this point, no probes were involved. It was always just like, come here and let me tell you about Atlantis. And, you know, then you and most of these books have a heavy snooze factor in places. Some are just absolutely wonderful. The one over there, I'll note, Flying Saucers on the Moon, whose cover looks like it was done by the editor's 8-year-old son. He was a wonderful writer. He was a British journalist who just went totally, he just went right way out there. And his books are filled with some of the loopiest things you can imagine. All written in English, though he does like exclamation points a whole lot. And slipping yep. into foreign languages without translation, especially mm-hmm. when he's investigating lost cities of the Incas in Peru.
The flying saucers of the 50s seem to be fairly benign.
They're fairly
except benign. For the movies. Movies where you had, but in the books and in the encounters with people, they seem to be, you know, just hanging out.
They're perfectly hanging out, you know.
And when did they become? Why were the movies different? Where you had space rays and Gort, Klaatu, Barada, Nikto, and all that.
Because it's much better in movies than having someone come than having
say,
than having Orthon and Furcon come in and to start talking to you about how, well, originally Saturn lay beyond the orbit of Jupiter, but then after, and just like and. Let's just say, not even Monogram.
Was it just a progression that people decided to spice things up by the time you got to the 80s with, you know, when you got to the probes and the more violent kinds of interactions?
What happened was, as long as there's still a lingering hint that science might be involved, up until the release of the scientific study on flying saucers that the government did, which took 18 months to say, no, we see absolutely no reason why we should keep studying these things. At which point, you know, the only people who were still interested were the people who tend to believe things more easily. And that's when the demographic began to split up, and you got cattle mutilations, you got Bigfoot working for the flying saucer people by catching rabbits for them. You have the spaceship moon, you have like ancient astronauts, you have von Däniken, and all those coming in. And then by the end of the 70s, then you've got Whitley Strieber coming in claiming, you know, he was the alien, the standard alien abduction where you're half asleep, you're carried away, you're hypnotized, you're probed, you're taken back, you're no advantage is gained at all to anyone, as near as can be told. And at that point, the stories just started to become more, not as pleasant. They just weren't, the little gray aliens just were not, they had nothing to recommend themselves. They had no advice from Atlantis. And they didn't really want to make friendships. They just wanted to have, you know, cold objects and, you know, and just say, is that cold? You know, and just, So, you know, sort of like that. But, and then by the 90s, you started getting more, let's just say, some more distasteful things going on as the conspiratologists really got into the act. There was a fellow, Milton Cooper, who did a very large and very well-known book, Ride a White Horse, I think, that was talking about flying saucers, that was talking about this, and happenstance in the middle of the book reprinted the entirety of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, just while noting that, wherever it says, you know, Zion, just wherever it says Goyim, just replace it with aliens. And just nonsense. I think he was later, I can't remember if he was one of the ones who was killed in a shootout with police later on or not. I know the fellow who used to own Giant Rock was, but that was before because it was believed he was an ex-Nazi or a Nazi at the time. And the police attacked him and accidentally blew up his store stash of dynamite. So one has no idea. But the Nazi flying saucers, of which there's a few upstairs, there's just the flying saucer people no longer had any good to do, except with the occasional person like, you know, Ruth Norman of Unarius, whose supporters you can see riding on the back of the Cadillac back then, all dressed up like Steve Martin doing his King Tut impersonation. But obviously, it's like, you know, there was still an element of fun with some groups.
But wasn't it thought to be some, you know, in retrospect, similar to the, like, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, that these were communist menace, or, I mean, the kind of the paranoia
of the
50s.
Menace and paranoia underlay all the beginnings, but was so bizarre, it didn't manifest itself within a John Birch-like mode until, except along the religious, you know, some of the fundamentalist preachers would issue tracts saying, men from the moon, do they come in spaceships or from Russia? And just and then the usual sort of things. But other than that, there are just like there's no malice really being seen until the 90s, and then there's as much malice being seen from the U.S. government as there one from anyone else.
I think part of the charm of your collection is that there is this sort of it does have a kind of innocence and naivete about it in retrospect. When you have books saying that spacemen approve the contents of this book.
That's on the cover. That's the
an imprimatur.
That's like the SJM imprimatur. Yes, exactly.
And that there's one of the books where you had an alien taken into the White House or the Pentagon.
Oh, Valiant Thor. Valiant Thor to meet President Kennedy and discuss the flying saucers. And
Valiant Thor is like Achilles, or he's a good-looking guy.
Oh, well, he's got this 50s pompadour. He looks like he might have been one of those. He looks like he might have sung with Dion back then. but you also get that sort of thing. Like over here, the combination of Bigfoot and Donald Duck. what you have, and that's like a drawing for almost from life, you could say.
You've donated your flying saucer library, as it's sometimes called, or a collection, or the university's acquired it.
The university acquired it.
Why did you decide to sell it, donate it, rid yourself of it?
It wasn't growing. It needed, I need more space at home. And second, it's just like these books they crumble. Books crumble. Sure. And so I wanted to put them someplace where they would be in good form, because this is like a collection that has been, over the past 20 years, the 50s and 60s stuff has sort of faded from memory much more than it used to. And I was happy to see them go to a place where they would be preserved and where people doing research or where people who just wanted to see these items could go and see them.
Now, I know that the Flying Saucer collection is just part of the Jack Womack Library of Crank Literature. What other things do you collect in the way of crank books?
Well, I've gotten rid of a whole lot of things. I still have my cryptozoology collection.
What is cryptozoology?
That's the study of sea serpents, Bigfoot, giant lizards of Nepal, the Mongolian sandworm, which is sort of like smaller versions of the ones in Dune. So that sort of thing. And I've got a reasonable number there. And then I have actual Fortean, which are accounts of Fortean phenomena, but just not by Fort, by John Keel mainly, though I do have all of Fort's first editions, and they're quite wonderful to read. And I even have Fort's novel, which is astounding because absolutely nothing happens in it. And it just goes along for a while, and then suddenly he breaks into this page of pure Fort. And it's just like, and the language is just so different. You can see him actually, discovering his perfect style to do this in.
I remember reading, I reviewed, in fact, Jim Steinmeier's biography of Fort.
Right.
Which came out a few years ago.
Right.
Very good.
Yeah.
So you've got the Fortiana. We've got the cryptozoology. How about the Atlantis, Lemuria?
I do have crank books on some select items from Atlantis, Lemuria, Mu, which is the third great lost continent. Books that are. I have one book that's printed entirely on blue paper, back in 1870s, because it was believed that if you had blue glass, it would provide for greater health. If you had little greenhouses attached to your house. And there are still a couple in San Francisco, I have heard, that have sun porches entirely with the original blue glass. And just to make it clear what they're talking about, every page is also printed on blue paper. Then I have Fish Who Answer the Telephone, which is sort of like, Z-List Pavlov. While he's actually, but it does have a wonderful illustration of fish answering the telephone.
Now, where do you find these books?
These became much easier to find after the internet. Before then, it was pretty much catch as catch can. But then by the late 90s, I had a list of about 350 books I was still looking for. And then around that time, ABE books came out and the internet became more accessible. And initially, no one knew what the price of anything was, so it was all cheap. Then everyone settled into, it's a used book, it must be worth $20. Mm-hmm. And so at that point, even the dollar books suddenly went up, and this is when you started seeing higher prices on like pretty much everything prior to just prices going up. But they've gone and just, you know, but I got them all. But then eventually I got all the ones I wanted. There are only just a couple remaining.
What are you looking for yet?
Orthodox Oxen of Science, I would be happy to find.
What's that?
It's an end to Heidi High Physics.
Okay.
That's the subtitle. and it's essentially one of these where I have a two-volume set called Ellen, which is Ellen is a little girl who's 12 years old who goes and has long discussions with a pine tree in the Vermont forest.
Oh, this is a famous book.
Yes.
If you go to Middlebury's, the Breadloaf School of English, they read from it every year.
Do they?
It's sort of their classic text.
Even the mathematical parts, because enormous parts of the book are devoted to squaring the circle, as you would hope.
But so will you one day donate these or sell them, or what is your plan for the rest of the Womack collection?
I would like to see them get to a place that is deserving of them. So
that's a good point, the place to stop and ask for some questions from the audience or comments or reactions. So please, if you have some questions, please raise your hand. I think there's a microphone.
My question is, are you familiar with Robert Goddard's moving to Roswell, New Mexico in the early 1950s?
I did know he did that. Robert Goddard? I thought,
yes.
When did Goddard die? I thought Goddard died in 46.
Well, he was the man of the year in 1953 in Roswell.
I heard he had gone out that direction. I was thinking it was earlier, but I could be wrong about that, because Robert Goddard was like one of the more sensible people involved. Mm-hmm. So naturally, I would have a minimum of stuff on anyone like that.
That's why I asked. I worked on his papers, and there was some evidence that the government actually moved him out there under the pretense that it had open sky, and he was working on personal rocket construction, and he wanted to do it outside of the United States government control. Mm-hmm. And then there was this speculation that he was actually brought out there because of the sightings.
Well, I haven't heard that. With Goddard, I would suspect it'd be more of the former than the latter. Mm-hmm. But and he was not the Tesla sort, so that, you know, he'd have been pretty straightforward, you know, with his dealings there. I'm going to need to look that up. As I say, Goddard is just fascinating character, and certainly the U.S. was accumulating all the rocket experts it could in the late 40s, though most of them were from Germany. No, that's a fascinating story, but I suspect if he went out there, it was because there are clear skies, ideal conditions for rockets. There was another fellow who went to the Mojave Desert with an infrared camera to take pictures of what he called space amoebas, which were living, because he believed UFOs were living life forms. But no one really picked up on that.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Over here in the front, there are two.
Jack, I've read the catalog. It's fabulous. A really wonderful book. One thing I didn't notice, though, much of, and maybe it's a later phenomenon, but sort of the religious aspect, the UFO cult, the Heaven's Gate. I know Gordon Melton, in one of his encyclopedias of American religion, there are dozens of UFO cults listed. And I don't think that sort of enters into your collection.
The Unarius people do.
I've got one of his bibliographies. No, it's George Edwards. His two-volume bibliography on UFOs is in the collection. There's a lot of individual volumes. The individual that a lot of those places didn't do books, or they did tracts, and that was the main reason why there's less. Anytime I'd see something like, you know, from the publisher of I Was a Cannibal, you know, Men on the Moon, who put them there? You know, just I would pick it up, of course, but that's just happenstance. And the Heaven's Gate, of course, I have the original book on when they first showed up as Bo and Peep back in the Pacific Northwest in the late 70s. And then I have the original book Brad Steiger, of course, wrote about them at the time, presenting them very positive. And then, but the Heaven's Gate, I didn't pick up any of the books on Heaven's Gate simply because by that point, it had just got, all the fun was out of it. I mean, to put it mildly. So it was just like, I mean, just like, do I want to really buy a book about a bunch of very sad people who did terrible things to themselves before committing mass suicide? I don't think so.
More questions?
Alternative medicine, most is garbage, but yet we have academic centers that look at this in a really in a scientific manner. So I'm curious, do you think this is worthy of an academic institution really to look into, and I wouldn't call it flying saucers, I would say unexplained phenomenon.
I think it's very worthy to look into as a sociological phenomenon, as a historical phenomenon, as an example of the human mind and all of its wonders, coming up with these sorts of things. So I think these are the aspects that make it worthy of study. It's just you're not going to find, you know, the lizard people of Jupiter coming out, but you're going to find why someone was thinking there might be lizard people from Jupiter, and just at what point and wow that developed, and why did they decide to present it in nonfiction form as opposed to writing a science fiction novel like that. So. But it's definitely worthy.
This question here.
Thank you. Okay, so you talked about the specific moment where, like, the term Men in Black was termed, and what was the other one? Flying saucers. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to know where along that timeline the idea of Area 51 came about.
That wasn't until at the very earliest, it would have been the late 70s. But it was mostly in the 80s. A lot of the Roswell stuff all came up in the 80s. And again, it seemed like vast elaborations upon incidents that didn't really create much comment at the time, even among flying saucer people. And it was post-81. And so there are very few things I have that are in there. I do have one wonderful children's book upstairs, which explains that to children that if you're abducted by aliens, it's a good thing, and let them do what they want. You know, you just think of the Dero emitting these evil chuckles. Area 51.
Have you ever met any of the authors of these books?
Let me try to think if I have. I think I've managed to avoid it. yes, there are a couple of people around, I'm told now, who don't like this book very much because I don't take things seriously enough. But c'est la vie. But in terms of most authors, I haven't. I haven't met anyone really.
Maybe one or two more questions. There's one here.
To what extent do you think the impulse behind flying saucer books, mythology, et cetera, is owed to the atmosphere of secrecy under which World War II was prosecuted?
That's part of it, and then that was definitely part of it because everyone was used to there being secrets, and this unhappening right so soon after the atomic bomb as well. Of course, the atomic bomb was often used by flying saucer people to explain, for explanations, saying that, Ah, well, flying saucers are always around, but you didn't see them until there was enough A-bomb radiation in the air to make them visible. That was one theory. But that does lead naturally into, you know, there was an area of secrecy. So they're used to it. Just the thing is that the secrecy had not yet taken on that evil aspect that it has since. So, but at the time it was just like, oh, it's secret. They're not telling us anything about it because, you know, they don't, you know, because it's like, you know, those A-bombs. They don't want, you know, they didn't talk about those either. And so, and I think that's a very good point in terms of just prepping people for getting them ready for, like, mysterious things out there that the government might be doing. It's just, as usual with everything, some people took it a little too far.
We didn't talk any about movies, but do you know what was the first movie to have feature flying saucers?
Oh, that would have been, I think, a movie called The Flying Saucer.
The Flying Saucer?
The Flying Saucer. It's extremely dull. and it's, believe it's 1950, I think. Mm-hmm. I'd have to double check that because movies, I'm not so up on facts off the top mm-hmm. as I am with the rest. But it was just called The Flying Saucer, and that was followed quickly by Rocket Ship KM, Destination Moon, mm-hmm. you know, and then those all proved fairly boring, so that's when movie folks came up with the idea of, oh, they must be evil aliens. Mm-hmm. And then you started getting the great classics, you know, coming right down to Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which I think is probably the best example.
I really like This Island Earth, where they were actually benevolent.
They were benevolent. But the other Body Snatchers is telling because it comes out of that communist fear, that conspiracy, along with you can't trust anyone who's around you. And notice that's the one they've done three different versions of since the 50s.
So our last question. I think, Bob, you had a question?
Talk about the connection between the Darrow and the Tholians.
The
Scientology. The Scientologists believe that the Earth is hollow and there are creatures that live in it, etc. I mean,
that was L. Ron's picking up science fictional concepts and using them for his own purposes in Scientology.
Mm. I mean, the hollow Earth goes back to the 19th century.
Oh, way
back. To a book called Simsonia. Yeah. And even before that.
And
that,
Voyage to the Center of the Earth.
That's after Simsonia.
Yeah. Is it? Okay. Yeah.
Simsonia was like
1830 or something like that.
1820, yeah. Because there's a monument. Then his son wrote the book.
Adam Seaborn. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And there are a lot of Hollow Earth
it's a wonderful
theories.
Well, thank you all for coming. Be sure to see the exhibition upstairs. We have beverages and snacks,
and John
is going to close
words.
The program.
And a closing remark.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Did I mention that I grew up in Los Alamos?
Ah.
Very good.
I do glow in the dark. Please join me in thanking our presenters one more time. I would also like to take a moment to thank our partners at Boo-Hooray and Anthology Editions in New York, who assisted with this exhibition and event, most especially Johann Kugelberg, unfortunately unable to join us this evening on account of illness, for his efforts to find, preserve, and place counterculture and popular culture collections such as this one. Thanks to the many library staff who have helped out on the exhibition and event, including, but not limited to, Ethan Henderson, Ann Galloway, Stephanie Hughes, Emily Minton, and Katie Thomas. I'd like to recognize and thank the members of the Library Associates in the audience. The Library Associates are our closest group of friends, providing vital support for all of the library's goals. If you enjoyed this evening, we hope you'll also consider getting involved with the library or even making a donation. We not only provide academic resources and spaces to the entire university community, but we also actively contribute to the life of the mind through lectures and programs and exhibitions like this one. Funds raised help us enhance these services and support Georgetown students, faculty, alumni, and neighbors. Finally, thank you once again to Jack Womack for entrusting his wonderful collection to us and for sharing his thoughts about it. After the exhibition closes at the end of May, the books will all be cataloged, and within a few months' time, they will be available for consultation and research upstairs in special collections, and perhaps you could be listed in a future edition of the 1978 book, now on display, A Survey of UFOlogists and Their Use of the Library. And thank you also to Michael Dirda for such a wonderful conversation, and thank you all for coming. Please join us now for the reception, and please don't miss this opportunity to view the exhibition upstairs on the fifth floor and decide for yourselves if flying saucers are real.